Welcome to EPG Padasala. I am Dr. K. Mavalirajan from Department of Ancient Indian History, Culture and Archaeology, Vishwabharati University, Shantiniketan, West Bengal. The subject, Indian Culture, the paper, Economy History of India from Earliest to 1707 AD. The module which I am going to discuss with you about the Cholas, Agriculture, Irrigation, Guild Organization. As we know very well about the Chola dynasty, they were very powerful rulers in South India. They controlled the Kaveri Delta regions. We can find several changes in the socio and the economic life of the Chola dynasty during from 9th to 13th century AD. The learning objective of the present modules to study about South Indian economy under the Cholas, to understand the land use pattern and method of cultivation, to study the sources of water supply and its management system, to emphasize the guild organization during the Chola period. When we introduce the subject first, the present map shows that the extension of the Chola Empire throughout the southern Indian part of Indian territories. The Cholas ruled a large part of southern India, including Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Andhra Pradesh, some parts of Karnataka from 9th to 13th century AD. In introduction part, when we discuss about the agrarian changes during the Chola period, many sources are available to understand the agrarian condition of Chola period. Thousands of inscriptions, many copper plates, some literary secular literatures also help us to understand the agrarian system of Chola period under the South Indian dynasty. The agrarian condition began to change significantly from the time of the Cholas. Most important changes were that of many forests and wastelands become cultivable land. The royal patronage was an important factor for the expansion of agriculture. The royal patronage even extended to the excavation of water tank is a marker of agrarian expansion during the Chola period. These agrarian changes increased the production, and the expanding economy led to the growth of trade and commerce, which emerged the emergence of guild organization in South Indian dynasty. In the agrarian history of Chola, we discuss about the land tenure pattern of the South Indian history. There were many kinds of land during the Chola period. We find both individual ownership right as well as the communal ownership right during Chola period. The individual ownership was called as Ehaboha rights, the communal rights known as the Jnanaboha rights. The waste land, forest land, and even pasture lands seems to have been held in common by village community. Some land described as being a part of common land, which is mentioned in South Indian inscription as Urpodu of the village. There are large number of evidences we have in inscriptions of communal ownership, which provide by the frequent use of the terms like Ur Manjikam, Ur Podu, which means the common land of the village. The Chola inscriptions also use the term Karayudu, which seems to indicate periodic redistribution of the common land in village level. The individual ownership which the Kani rights of land was closely associated. The individual Kani rights mean rights of inheritance, which means ennudaya over lands, the right of ownership which was being transferred by the seller or donor. The Kani rights holder enjoyed privileged life in the hereditary based possession of land. The term Kani was originally interpreted by scholars like Noboru Kareshima, Y. Subbarayalu. They mean Astaboha rights, which is the rights to absolute ownership of the cultivable land in the agrarian system. Heitzman shows Kani rights to indicate a troop ranging from Nilakani, Ulavukani, and Padavukani. The Nilakani, which is the ownership right of land, Ulavukani, which mean the cultivation right of the land, and Podukani and Padavukani shareholding. The emergence of a number of big landlords by the late Chola period is indicated by several titles such as Udayan, Kilavan, Alvan, and Arayan. So, the landholding pattern on the basis of the Chola inscriptions, we can find both communal ownership as well as the individual ownership during the Chola period. Now we discuss about the different type of the landholding system during the Chola period. Three types of landholding existed: Vellan Vahai, Brahmadeya, and Devadana. These are the three types of landholding pattern which prevalent during the Chola period. It has been suggested by scholars that there was only collective holdings in early Tamil country up to the 20th century AD. Gradually, they developed individual ownership of land. The basic unit of the agrarian society of the Chola period was village-based. In the village, we can find mostly the individual ownership rights as the kind of the ehaboha rights of the village people. The inscription of Chola referred those villages as the Vellan Vahai villages, which means mostly it is the cultivable land which cultivated by the peasant cultivator. The Vellan Vahai village was considered as the communal ownership of village land. In the Vellan Vahai villages, initially all the lands was owned by the community known as Urar. The Urar were the inhabitant of the Ur. Each individual of the community had the right to receive a particular share in the entire land of the Vellan Vahai villages. Hence, every individual of the Ur was personally called as the owners or Udayar of the whole village. These individual families organized agriculture by themselves, and therefore there was no scope for basic stratification. So, on the basis of this, the Vellan Vahai landholding pattern, it's cultivated by the peasant itself. Mostly the production from the common cultivation, it's commonly shared by all the cultivators of the village of the Chola country. Apart from the Vellan Vahai, the ownership right of the land, we also find Brahmadeya and Devadana kind of land holding during Chola period. The Brahmadeya was the land donation to the Brahmins. The Devadana was the land donation to Brahmins. Mostly, the Devadana villages had been vested under the custody of temple. The temple and its functionary could not operate the agricultural activity directly. Hence, the temple lands were given in lease to some individual. Those individuals did not directly perform agricultural operations. They in turn organized the agriculture through some cultivators of village. Thus, in Devadana land tenure, a multi-tier agrarian setup evolved, namely landlord, the ownership or tenant, and cultivator. This led to the emergence of a feudal setup in the Chola agrarian system. So, in the landholding pattern of the Chola period, the Vellanvahi villages, Brahmadeya villages, and Devadana villages played vital role in the agrarian development of the Chola period. Now we concentrate on the agriculture and agricultural practice of Chola dynasty. Expansion of areas under cultivation done through three different directions. Reclamation of forests and wasteland. Through the formation of Brahmadeya and Devadana lands were the major features of early and medieval Chola agriculture. The expansion of wet crop cultivation in particular was a major transforming factor in the landscape of early medieval Tamil country. Growth of population was one of the most important factors that led to the emergence of new settlements in the Chola period. The next equally important causes was the production pattern, which depended on increase in the area under cultivation in order to increase the volume of production in village level. This is the earliest settlement of the agrarian settlement. We can find the distribution of the agrarian settlement in a particular place of the Chola period. In agricultural pattern, Kural extol the glory and greatness of the farmers and their occupations. It reflect the existing condition of those times and emphasize the importance of agriculture in his famous Thirukural. This is evident from the following couplets. Husband, man, ulavar are the seat anger of the world, for on them depends the lives of the others. Even saints who have forsaken the world needs must release from the spiritual pursuits, were farmers to sit idle with folded arms. In one of his another sayings, he says that Uludundu Valvare Valvar Matrellam Toludundu Pinselvar, which means the flow man alone lives, as on free men of the soil, the rest are mere slaves that batten on their toil. There are some other kurals which says about the glorified agricultural practice of the early Tamil society. Now we discuss about the agricultural pattern and agricultural crops of the Chola period. There are many references to the cultivation of different food crops in the Sangam literature and other historical sources. Medieval inscriptions speaks of different varieties of food crops. The Chola inscriptions also gives details about the cultivation of the crops, which the rice field, which speaks about the rice field of sugarcane, the graves of palm trees, lanterns, and the others which grow near the Kaveri River. One of the famous the copper plate of the Cholas, the Udayendram copper plates, which mention different varieties of the crops such as araka palms, coconut trees, mango trees, palmyra, under various trees of the Chola times. References to mango, banana, coconut, orange, lime, jackfruits and crabs are found in medieval Chola records. Chola records also speaks about the different cultivation of different dry crops like varahu, rahi, kambu, samai, millet, black gram, dal, pulse, horse gram, etc. These agricultural products of those days were self-sufficient, and we also have the references to surplus of the agricultural product. These surplus products were carried through the commercial activities from the village to the urban centers. We find description of such carts carrying imported goods in the literature of early Tamil country. Now we discuss about the different method of cultivation in the agrarian process. The Chola adopted a different method of cultivation basis of the availability of water resources. Three different systems of cultivation were adopted during the Chola period. There were owner himself cultivated the land with the help of his family members. Owner looked after the land with the help of the laborers and farm servants. Owner himself gave the lands to the tenant on lease. The Brahmin and temple lands were always cultivated by the tenant cultivator of the Chola village. On the basis of the availability of water sources, the cultivated area was divided into three categories: wet, dry and garden lands. The wetlands were called Nanjai, the dry land were known as Punjai, and garden land was Totakal. The Chola inscription referred these lands as the Nanjai, Punjai and Totakal land. The wetlands and dry lands were also known as Neernilam and Kollai Nilam. Another inscriptions call these land as Neeraramban and Kattaramban. In wetland cultivation, there were generally two harvests, one is kar and another one is pasanam. Occasionally, there was a third crop which was called as kadaipu, which means they cultivate in the third time as the agricultural product. For the agricultural process, the Cholas used different agricultural implements for their agricultural cultivation. The early people used various implements for the agricultural processing. In ancient Tamilakam, the agricultural implements found in burial of Adichanallur, even some of the places of the archaeological excavated places of Kodumanal and Adichanallur, we got some references of the agricultural tools and implements which mainly used during the Chola period for the cultivation process. According to Irwan Habib, the plow appeared in South India in the second millennium BC, which basically Neolithic culture. The use of the plow we can find in literature during the early days of ancient Tamil country. There are references to Meli, Nanjil are the two most commonly used terms in the poem for plow or air for ploughshare. The term preferred to act of flowing, ulavu, and therefore the terms eror and ulavur is used for plowman. These are the some of the agricultural tools which used by the early Tamils for their agricultural process. There are also some interesting references in Kamba Ramayanam about the different agricultural tools. There are references to plow, plow handle, large nail, the yoke and socket, iron wooden rod which hold the yoke in position, the rope that ties the yoke to the neck of the bull, the plow point, the nail that joined the plow point to plowshare, whip in the hands of the peasant, the ox or bull that flows, a leveler called Manvetti or Mammetti, where also we get in the Kamba Ramayanam. So, in agricultural method, the people of the Sangam period used a different method of cultivation and also used different varieties of the tools and agricultural implements. Now we discuss about the irrigation system of Chola period. The irrigation system, they followed both natural and artificial water sources for the irrigation of their land. In the artificial sources, mostly the tank and well irrigation were the most important irrigation system, which mainly used for the watering the land. In the natural water sources, the river water played vital role in the agricultural expansion. As agriculture depends largely on irrigation, both natural and artificial water sources were utilized for by farmer. Mostly in the from canals and water cultivation to the field through the small canals, well irrigation was especially suited for garden crops. Water from wells was lifted up by means of pulley, a kind of water lifting from the well to the water field. In the natural water resources, the river water is important. Kaveri River was the main river of the Chola land. Early Chola kings tried to a great extent to harness the natural resources of the water. For instance, the early Chola king Karigala Cholan controlled the Kaveri water and constructed a dam across river Kaveri. He is also credited with cleaning of the jungle, introduction of agricultural settlements, construction of many water sources, construction of dam across the Kaveri, digging of several canals for the promotion of agriculture. This is the Kallanai Dam, which is constructed by the early Chola king Karigala Cholan. Next, we discuss about the tank irrigation of the Chola period. The Chola king promoted and patronaged for the promotion of irrigation system. The construction of irrigation tanks seems to become well established by the medieval Chola period. It was taken up as a mission by a ruling class and rich section of society. Many Chola inscriptions referred to the construction of water tanks. There was a rapid increase in the number of tanks constructed from the 10th century onwards. Due to the large changes in the irrigation method, there was a tremendous agrarian expansion during the rule of the imperial Cholas, more particularly in the Kaveri Delta regions. The Tamil work Vishwakarma Vastu Sastra narrates in detail construction of a big tanks, small tanks and wells during the Chola territory regions. The tank irrigations, which referred in Chola inscription as Eri, we get several inscriptions of construction of Eri by the royal officials as well as the individual owners of the Chola period. The Eri were considered as the important source of irrigation. In medieval South Indian inscriptions, we find many references to a different Eri. There are references to Vairameha Tadaha of Uttaramerur, the Chola Varisai of Solingur and Rajendra Chola Pereri at Punganur were constructed for agricultural expansion. Parandaga first constructed a lake named Veeranamyeri near Kattumannar Koyil in Southarka district. Other famous lake of this period are Madurandagam, Sundarachola Pereri, Kundavai Pereri, which named after the Chola queen of the Chola period. The Chola rulers constructed tank for the promotion of agriculture. The Chola king Rajendra first constructed a huge tank known Chola Gangam in Gangaikonda Cholapuram. It had many sluices and canal to provide water to a large area of north of the Kollidam river. Overflow of the Chola Gangam made Veeranam Eri. There were several channels and feeder channel, and tank was partly filled by channel from the Kollidam river. According to Karandai copper plate of Rajendra, the Parandaga first excavated hundreds and thousands of deep stream to make earth fertile. A lake, Veeranarayana Pereri, evidently named after his title. Three channels named after him, namely Singalandahan, Sri Parandahan and Irumudi Cholan, are mentioned in the Karandai copper plates. Now we discuss about the canal irrigation. Long canals were constructed and used for irrigation to carry water from the river, lake and tank. Most of the distributary canals of the Kaveri river belongs to Chola period. There are namely Uyyakondan canal, Rajendra Vaikal, Sembiyan Mahadevi Vaikal, which is the best example for the canal irrigation during the Chola period. In the artificial irrigation system, well irrigation is most important. The Chola gave importance to well irrigation in and around Thanjavur regions. The wells were called Kinaru in Tamil, were mostly used for irrigation in the individual plots of land. People used a different method of lifting water from the well, mostly yetram or kamalai. These are the devices which used by the early Tamil people to lift the water from the well. This picture shows the method of water lifting or kamalai yetram from the well, mostly the lifted water from the well they used for watering the agricultural field. For the maintenance of water resources, the Chola created a separate varium known as Erivarium. The Erivarium played vital role in controlling and managing the irrigation system of the early Chola period. The village tank committee was looked after the maintenance of the tank and other water sources. The committee functioned as a committee of village assembly. The famous Uttaramerer inscription of Parandaga, we speak about the functions and the different activities of the Erivarium to regulate the irrigation system of the early Chola period. This body consisted of 6 members who held office for 360 days and then retired from the service. The Erivarya committee was in main concerned with raising the resources and their utilization of maintenance of irrigation works. It is mentioned in an inscription that an irrigation committee raids the banks of river Kaveri to protect cultivable lands from flood water. Strict rules and regulations were implemented to protect irrigational projects from unwanted damages. People made arrangements among themselves that they should not cause any damage to the well tanks and other water sources. Any deliberate attempt to damage irrigational tanks was considered as crime. They were severely punished by the Chola state. Now we discuss about the guild organization. In the promotion of the economic activities or in the promotion of economic development, the guild organization played a vital role. We find several references in the Chola inscription for different guild organizations like Manigramam, Ayyavol, Anjuvannam, Nanadesi, Naharathar, and other several types of the guild organization. In medieval times, the corporate trading communities were called as guilds. The guilds was a well-organized association which involved in commercial activities of the Chola country. The development of guild system is an interesting feature of ancient Indian economic history. The function of merchant guilds were not confined to only the economic activities, they also involved in the socio-religious and administrative affairs of the Chola country. From the economic point of view, the guilds can be divided into five categories. The first one category, guilds as a joint commercial undertaking with capital of their own sangha. Guilds of skilled worksmen who were supplied material by capitalists and were paid according to their outturn. Guild of lower class of artisans. Guilds of various grades of materials and low class worksmen. Guilds of men of various occupation and worksmen, etc. Guilds of Chola country. The merchant community of the Chola country had their own guild organization depending upon the goods they handled. The community, those who handled the horses as their commercial goods, were called as in the generic term chettis. The oil merchants were called Sangarapadiyar. The weaver community involved in the textile trade were called Saliyas. The Naharathar, Naharathu Chettis were powerful merchant groups controlled the Naharam and its administrative machinery. We find in inscription various kind of the guilds of South India. The merchant guilds who involved in the transaction of the commercial goods were called by several names. There were references to Manigramam, Ayyavol, Nanadesi, Anjuvanna Vanigar, Thisai Ayirathu Ainutravar, Anjuvannathar, Chitrameli Periyanattar, Valinjiyar, Padinan Bhumi Vishayathar, and Naharathar. The trade guilds impacted in several ways in the economy of Chola period. It was because of the trade activities of the merchant guilds, there was a marked increase in commercial transaction of the guilds from the 6th to 14th century AD. They established their sway even in foreign countries. The trade guilds enjoyed their power in Tamil country and exercised their commercial supremacy in many trade and market centers. Besides trade, they involved in multidimensional work like charity, social welfare, judicial, and temple endowments. They contributed much for the development of economy of medieval Tamil country as well as in spread of Indian culture to the foreign countries. Thus, it can be concluded that water sources was the central regulator of agricultural activity. And so the long-term policy of the people had mainly focused on the development of irrigation. They tried to control water flow as well as store the rainwater for the improvement of cultivation. Various sources of water supply were in practice during the study period, which facilitated agricultural activities. The state role in this record was quite satisfactory, though private initiative were much more impressive. As agriculture was the mainstay of the country's economy, developed irrigation facilities were provided for the betterment of agriculture, which helped directly to the economic progress. Inscription as well as literary sources shows that the Chola rulers were conscious about the welfare of their people and they took interest for the development of irrigation system. To sum up, the Chola paid much important for the agrarian expansion. The patronage for the promotion of irrigation facility. They also encouraged the guild organizations for the transaction of the commercial goods in inland or the foreign countries. Thank you very much for watching the video. For further references, you can visit EPG Podasala website.